Hello everyone. So today I have come up with new topic, that is failure analysis. So in today's class we will see introduction to failure analysis, which includes theoretical portion of static failure analysis, fatigue failure analysis, as well as buckling analysis. So let's get started for tutorial number 50. So introduction to failure analysis. Structure such as bridges, aircraft and machine component can fail in many different ways. So engineers have identified three ways of failure. First is static failure, second is fatigue failure, and third is buckling failure. So first we will see what is meant by static failure. An overloaded, the load is static. An overloaded structure may experience permanent deformation. The load acting on any body, the load may be static, but it may cause permanent deformation, means it will cross its elasticity and it enters into its plastic zone, so it will not regain its original shape. So such component is not of use in many cases. So that is nothing but failure, which can lead to compromised function or failure of the entire structure. So the best example I will say, nut and bolt assembly. If thread are change its shape and it gets permanent deformation, then it will not get locked it with each other, means it will not get meshed, so it is not any use. So that in that case we don't require permanent deformation. So that is the static failure. Then next is fatigue failure. A structure subjected to millions of small repeated load, means we have any structure, we have any component. Let us consider the example of a connecting rod or crankshaft. It is having the repeated load. So here the load intensity may be less or may be large, but the load is repeated. Means once you experience the tensile load, then you experience the compression. Once you experience the tensile stresses, then in the next cycle you will experience the compressive stresses. In this case, a structure may have slow growth of surface cracks that can cause material strength degradation and a sudden failure. So this is very important. Slow growth of crack may take place, and at any point you will get the failure of that particular component. And the third is buckling failure. Now this is a very specific thing, buckling failure. When a slender structure is loaded in a compression, it may undergo an unexpected large deformation and lose its ability to carry loads. Means any object which is under the action of compressive load. Best examples are columns that we see on the in the bridges. Means any bridge or any flyover, you can see we can see the series of columns there, and that all columns are under the compressive load. If the load is very large, then that particular column may get shrink. That particular process is nothing but compressive stress is increasing, due to which buckling take place or crushing take place. We will see that thing in the detail in upcoming slides. So these are the three types of failure we have. So what we have concluded, failure analysis plays an important role in improving the safety and reliability of an engineering structure. Here the word comes, safety and reliability. That's why we are thinking about complete, or we are studying this particular thing, failure analysis. Here safety and reliability is very important, because we can't design anything that we can rely on it. If we give any design or any machine component and we'll say we are not taking the guarantee of it, whether it will fail or not, then nobody will buy from us. So this is very important being a mechanical engineer. So let's get started with further process. So now we'll see first static failure. So guys, what is failure of machine element or object? So this is the thing which we have seen earlier. Under static loading condition, material failure can occur when structure is stressed beyond its elastic limit. Every object have its elastic limit, and it gets stressed more than its elastic limit. We are considering it as a failure. So what is that failure design working allowable or permissible stress of static loading? We have given various names. Some call it as failure, some call it as design stress, some call it as a working, some call it as allowable or permissible stresses. So we are considering for the ductile material. So here we have this stress strain diagram for ductile material. Everyone knows what is this thing. And we are having SYT, that is yield point tensile strength, and SUT is ultimate tensile strength. At SYT, we are considering it as a its yielding stress. So that much amount of stress we can't produce in our object if it is made up of that particular material. Every material has different stress strain curve. Every material has have different SYT, different SUT. If we consider the mild steel component, and if you are having the yield point strength of 210 MPa, I am just taking the example. If any mild steel having the SYT 210 MPa, and if I applied some XYZ load on it, and that particular mild steel component produced the stress around 250 or 270 MPa, then blindly we can say that that particular thing is failed. We will not consider that much amount of stress in our object. So this is the role of SYT. We have the SUT point also, but if we consider the ductile material and we have the sure shot SYT, then we need not to look at the SUT. SUT will be we will think about SUT in the brittle material. So everyone knows about this. This is very basic thing. So failure stress is what? Failure stress is yield point stress divided by factor of safety. So we consider factor of safety 2, 3, 4 as per the our requirement. Optimization can change its factor of safety. Nowadays in many automobile company you might be surprised that they are playing with the factor of safety in the range of 1.1 and 1.2, whereas we in the theoretical we are considering factor of safety 2, 3, 4, 5, whatever we want. So this much of flexibility is not in the industry. In industry you have to be optimized. So failure stress, yield point stress divided by factor of safety. So our yield point stress is 210, factor of safety is 210 divided by 2. So whatever the amount, that is 105 MPa is the allowable stress we get. And if our component goes beyond the 105 MPa, then we will say that that component will fail, because our factor of safety is saying that you can't raise your stress beyond the failure stress. So this case is for ductile material. So what conclusion we can draw? If stresses developed in object due to static loading is higher than the failure stress, then we can say that object is failed. So being a designer, it's designing aim to keep stress below failure stress. Being a designer, we have to keep our stress below the failure stress. So this is our ultimate aim while doing the failure. So this is about the ductile material. Now we will see same thing for the brittle material. And now what happened in the brittle material? We have the brittle material curve, which we can see. In brittle material, there is one thing we can see, that you can see through the animation, that we will directly get SUT. So there is no SYT point, because due to brittleness, it is not having that much of elasticity. It directly go to the ultimate point and it get directly failed. So we have the SUT, we don't have SYT, clear SYT point in the brittle material. But concept remains same. Failure stress is here failure stress is ultimate point stress divided by factor of safety. But one important thing we need to remember, that the value of factor of safety is here higher than the value of factor of safety in the ductile material, because ultimate point stress is very high. Ultimate stress is very high means you will get mild steel ultimate stress around 480 MPa. So if want to reduce it to below, it's rather I'll say any cast iron material, not mild steel. Mild steel is ductile. Any cast iron, if we consider, its ultimate stress is around 450 MPa, and we want to draw it to the 100 or 50 MPa, then the thing which is in the denominator, it must be higher. It is pure mathematics. I don't want to go into that much of depth, otherwise it will become pure theoretical thing. So failure stress, whatever we get in the brittle material, but the only important thing that the factor of safety is higher as compared in the brittle material. Otherwise, everything is same. If stresses developed in object due to static loading is higher than failure stress, then we can say that object is fail. So being a designer, it is designing aim to keep stress below the failure stress, same as the ductile material. So guys, we are talking about the static loading. So after that particular thing, means whatever the design stress we have decided, this is the way we can treat static loading for failure. We have the theories of failure for static loading. Whenever a machine part is subjected to a system of a combined stresses like axial, bending and torsional, means any object which is under the action of these three different type of loading, axial loading, bending loading and torsional loading, it is very important to know the cause of failure. Generally, there are two types of failure. First is elastic failure or yielding, that is excessive deformation of the part. What we have discussed earlier, excessive deformation, if it goes above its elastic zone and it enters into its plastic zone, then it will not regain its original shape, and vice versa, stresses is also increased. And fracture failure, that is component tears apart into two or more pieces, means what type of failure you are expecting from it. Do you want to fail completely into two part, or do you want some warning kind of thing? Because if it fracture into two part, means it may cause human life as well. So being a designer, we need to take care of this thing. So elastic failure or yielding is something which we are targeting. So for that, we have to find out maximum principal stresses, that is sigma 1 and sigma 2. This is strength of material in the engineering second year. You have studied this particular subject, where you can find out this thing, sigma 1 and sigma 2. These are the maximum principal stresses. Same thing you can find out using the graphical way, that is using the Mohr circle as well. So guys, if you have any doubt related to this kind of thing, I have another playlist which is related to strength of material. You can visit it also. So we have to find out the sigma 1 and sigma 2, that is the maximum and minimum principal stresses. And using that value, we have four different theories of failure. First is maximum normal stress theory, that is given by Rankin. It has its own formula, sigma 1 is equals to SYT upon factor of safety. Then maximum principal strain theory, which is having the formula, maximum shear stress theory. Then distortion energy theory, which is the von Mises theory. So this is the stress we will look for. And these theories are can be used for the different material. Brittle material generally goes for the first theory. Ductile material uses maximum principal strain theory, whereas the if it is not pure tension, then the maximum shear stress theory is not applicable there. Then the generally gives good result, that is distortion energy theory, means maximum stresses value what we get while we solve the problems is the von Mises stresses we generally calculated, that is distortion energy theory, through which we are getting the values. So this is the static loading, and these are the formulas for that static loading for the failure, and using that we can find out either the factor of safety or we can find out the maximum or principal stresses as well. If we have the value of maximum and principal stress, we can calculate the factor of safety, and if we have allowed to consider factor of safety whatever we want, then we can calculate the sigma 1 and sigma 2 as well. So that is the stress. In this way we can calculate theoretically theories of failure for static loading. In software enhances you, that particular logic is different, but it is calculated in a different way. So this thing we should take care that theories of failure, how it works. So now the most important topic is fatigue failure. So let's get started with fatigue failure. So first we should know what is completely reversed or cyclic stresses. So whatever diagram you can see here, we have considered the shaft which is rotating and upper layer, that is the point A, which is you can see here, point A here, which is under the action of compressive stress. At the same time, below this particular point B or particular fiber is under the tensile stress. This is pure our imagination. It may reverse: above is tensile, below is compressive. So A is under compression, B is under tension. So let's see what happened. In a diagram show below, upper fibers of beam, that is point A, is under compression stress, and lower fiber, that is point B, under tensile stress. After half revolution, point A occupies point B position and vice versa. See what happened after 180 degree. After 180 degree, what happened? Point A occupies the position of B and B occupies the position of A. Now that the fiber which at lower level now goes upward and that at top goes below, means the upper layer now is under the tension and lower layer under the compression, means the initially which is under the tension now in the compression, and initially which is under the compression now is under the tension. So the thing is that that particular stress is changing on the fiber, compression to tension, tension to compression. Now point B under compressive stress and A at tensile stress, for each revolution stresses are reversed, which varies compressive to tensile and vice versa. So such type of stresses is known as completely reversed or cyclic stresses. I mean, this is completely reversing compression, tension, tension, compression. So this is known as completely reversed or cyclic stress. This is very important, guys. This is the load type which we are thinking about, how things are changing. The stresses which vary from one value of compressive to the same value of tensile or vice versa, known as completely reversed or cyclic stress. Means magnitude of compression and tension will remain same, and compression to tension and tension to compression. So in this way it is interchanging. So we have three types of stresses for that. First is fluctuating stress. What happened in a fluctuating stress? Vary from minimum value to maximum value of the same nature, that is tension to the compression, but the nature is same. Here what happened in a fluctuating load, if we have the stress value of 10 megapascal to 150 megapascal, listen guys, we have the stress value 10 megapascal to 150 megapascal, but it is a tensile loading. It goes from 10 to 150, 150 to 10, 10 to 150, 150 to 10, but only tension, there will be no compression. So such loading is known as fluctuating stress. Then another is a repeated stress, which varies from 0 to certain maximum value. It starts from 0 and goes to the certain maximum value, whether it nature may be different. And the last is alternating stress. It varies from minimum value to maximum value of opposite nature, that is minimum compression to maximum tension. So this is very different thing. Here what happened? Minimum to maximum means at some location it is having minimum compression, in next cycle it will have the maximum tension. So this is the alternating stress, which is alternating the value. So this is the most common type of stress you will get. So I have one more thing to say about that before we will see this what is meant by fatigue and fatigue failure. So here we come the word fatigue. Fatigue, it has been found experimentally that when material is subjected to repeat stress, it fails at stresses below the yield point stress. Such type of failure of material is called fatigue. Fatigue means tiredness, we all know, and this particular thing when arises, that experimentally proven that due to such kind of repeated stress, that particular object, any object, failed very below stress level, which we have margin for the static loading. We have calculated the static loading, the what we called it as a failure stress, or we named it as the permissible stress. But if same object is under the fatigue loading, it may get fail under the permissible or the failure stress as well, means below very very low stress value due to fatigue, due to repeated loading, you may find out the failure of the object. I will explain that thing once again. So fatigue failure, it has been observed that material fails under the fluctuating stress at stress magnitude which is lower than its yield strength. Okay, it has been found that magnitude of the stress causing fatigue failure decreases as the number of stress cycle increases. Now there is one more thing, if the stress cycles are increasing, the stress value is goes on decreasing, means our repeated load is for say 1000 cycle and we are starting from the 10 to 100, 100 to 200. If for first 100 cycle our stress value is 70 megapascal, means it can sustain for first cycle 70 megapascal kind of stress it can sustain, but when it goes from 100 to 200 and now the 70 megapascal stress is acting on that body, then it may get fail. Means as the number of cycle goes on increasing, the capacity of it to get stress is also decreasing. So both are inversely proportional. This phenomenon of decreased resistance of material to the fluctuating stress is the main characteristics of fatigue failure. So this is very important thing that we can learn today, that decreased resistance of a material to the fluctuating stress is the main characteristics of fatigue failure. So fatigue failure is defined as a time delayed fracture under cyclic loading. So example, I will take very small example how fatigue failure takes place. You will agree with this particular thing. Any normal human being, take 1 mm steel wire. You have seen 1 mm steel wire, okay, which is generally used for the construction purposes, and try to get tensile loading by your hand. Apply tensile loading by your hand and you will never break that 1 mm steel wire with your hand, whether 1 mm other material, non-metallic material, you can break into two parts, means let's consider any string, okay. So you can put it, you apply the tensile load, that particular 1 mm string you can divide it into two parts. But now when the metallic part, 1 mm steel wire, try to grab it in a hand and try to give tensile loading, you will never break that thing into two parts. But same 1 mm wire, if you trying to twist it reversibly, means if you try to twist in on both way, upward downward, upward downward, at some point that particular steel wire get failed into or get teared into or get break into two different parts. So this is what, because of fatigue, that particular portion at which it breaks, that particular portion is experiencing the compression tension type of loading, that is the cyclic loading, and it can't sustain that cyclic loading and it gets failed. I am come up with another example. Now see carefully, this is the bicycle pedal and this is the sprocket where that this connecting rod, I'll say this particular rod is connected here and same is here. Now see the foot position here. This foot position is going downward and here you will get the reaction. So this is the compression. Are you agree? Then see this particular rod. It is going downward and this is the tension. Now what happened when this particular leg goes downward and this particular leg goes upward? Same part is at below and same part is above, means this part will experience the tension and this part will experience the compression, and this particular cyclic load is carried out on this particular cycle part. So this particular cyclic loading may cause the failure of this particular part. So when designing such parts, this particular part fails under the fatigue. So it is the designer's job to ensure that what type of failure occurs on any machine element, and according to that it design it. Now it is clear that this particular part is under the alternating loading. So designer make sure while designing it, it will fail in the fatigue loading. So designer make sure that it will not get failed in the fatigue failure. So vary from this is the alternating stress, which vary from minimum value to the maximum value of opposite nature, that is minimum compression to maximum tensile. So we have come up with another terminology, that is fatigue life. It is a mechanical and a scientific term that relates how long an object or material will last before completely failing because of its concentrated stress. Life, the word come up with life means it is telling us that its span, for what span it will remain there, and after that it will get fail. Here fail means completely break. So fatigue life we have to decide. So fatigue life is divided into two parts, that is first is finite life and another is infinite life. Finite life is for some definite time duration, and infinite life, designer design it for the infinite life means it will never get failed. So while we see about the finite life, we should know the two point, that is low cycle and high cycle. And while infinite life, it will cover endurance, stress or strength. We will see what is this. So any this is very important guys. Any fatigue failure when the number of stresses cycle are less than 1000 is called as a low cycle fatigue. If cycle is less than 1000, means cyclic loading is less than one cycle, then we will call it as a low cycle fatigue. And if it is greater than 1000, then we will call it as a high cycle fatigue. So here one question arises, means if the cycles are less than 1000, means it is having the large stress carrying capacity. As I have told you earlier, that stress is inversely proportional to the number of cycle, means as the number of cycle increasing, the stress value decreasing. Vice versa, if we want to take stress value or stress carrying capacity high of our object, then the cycles we must reduce. So below 1000, high stress but low cycle. Above 1000, low stress but high cycle. So this thing is very clear. We must keep this thing in the mind. So before going forward, we have one more terminology, that is fracture mechanics. Means you might have seen the failure of object. You can see the crack going on the object. That is nothing but failure. If you see any crack in the building as well, that is nothing but failure. Yes, it will sustain the load, but we can't give the guarantee. So that fracture in the building or that fracture in any gear component or generally brittle material goes under the fracture. So see, the concept of fracture mechanics begins with the assumption that all components contain microscopic level cracks. In a ductile or a brittle material, when the localized stress near crack reaches the yield point, there is a plastic deformation resulting in the redistribution of stresses. For ductile material, it is serious, but the brittle material, it is serious. Means for ductile material, it is not serious, sorry. Ductile material, it is not serious, but for brittle material, it is serious because there is inability of plastic deformation. If crack happens in the ductile material, then it is not that much serious thing, because it is having the expansion with it, because it is having the high elastic limit, and I'll say it is ductile, so it can expand. But in case of brittle, it is not having any choice, because it is having very less plastic deformation. So fracture mechanics is the science of predicting the influence of cracks and crack like on the brittle fracture component. So this is the fracture mechanics. Now we'll see what is crack propagation. When a component containing a small microscopic crack is subjected to an external force, there is an almost instantaneous propagation of the crack, leading to the sudden and a total failure. Means if we say a small crack we can get it, we can get crack propagation suddenly all over the body and it may get failed. We have seen in a numerous movies as well. Consider the example of dam. When a sudden small kind of crack happen goes into that particular concrete structure, that crack get propagate throughout all the walls of that particular dam, because huge amount of hydro pressure is behind that particular wall. It is beyond our imagination that huge amount of pressure is there, and sudden kind of any small crack may lead to very hazardous, means it may cause numerous life due to that failure. So while designing that thing, we need to consider very carefully. So propagation of crack is like tearing cloth. It gets propagation means it gets tearing cloth. You might have the clear idea. I have given you the example, best example you have seen various Hollywood movie or Bollywood movie, this thing. Once you start little tear, it will propagate rather easily across the full length of the cloth. For propagation of a crack, less force is required. Crack propagation depends upon the fracture toughness, stress intensity factor. So this is the very important thing. This thing is also you have learned in the strength of material, if I am not wrong. So see how thing happen. First position is small crack, and then crack growth. The lifespan of from small crack to the crack growth, still it get into two part, is nothing but the total life of that particular object. This is an idealization of the fatigue design process. So what is the philosophy of fatigue? There are three main fatigue design philosophies. It centers around one of the fatigue life estimation methodologies. So we'll see what are the three methodologies. First is safe life. Now here what happened? Products are designed to survive a specific design life. Full scale tests are usually carried out with the margins of safety applied. This philosophy adopts the crack initiation method and is used on a part and component that are relatively easy and inexpensive to replace and not life threatening. So where the risk is less, it is less costly, where we can change the things very easily, here we can use this particular thing. Means if I want to give the example, such a safe life philosophy we can use in the automobile industry. That are relatively what it is saying, that this philosophy adopts the crack initiative method and is used on parts and components that are relatively easy and inexpensive to replace and not life threatening if failure were occur. I am repeated that thing. Most of the life is taken up in the initiation of the crack. The propagation of that crack is very rapid and short in compression. Example, ground vehicle industry, what I have given the example earlier. In ground vehicle industry, let us consider the connecting rod or the crankshaft. If crankshaft suddenly get failed, it is very less life means I'll say life threatening. Vehicle may stop, but vehicle not get into the accident. But whereas the in case of brake, if brake fails, then it may cause the life. So various part depends, it depends upon the part as well. So in the ground vehicle industry, this particular thing is happened. I will give you the example. Consider this tool. This tool is having three legs. Okay, if any one of the leg is removed, then that stool will collapse. But to sustain the load, stool must have at least three leg to sustain that particular load. Without three leg, it will not stand. So it is very optimized solution. Now we'll go to the fail safe, another philosophy. So these are the philosophies while we design the object for the fatigue failure. In this, where a failure must be avoided at all cost, means we don't want failure, there will be no room for the failure. And if the structure were to fail, it must fall into state such that it would be survived until repairs could be made. Means if anyhow that particular component or object get fail, then it can survive up till it get repaired. So this philosophy is heavily used in the safety critical items such as in the aerospace and offshore industry. Guys, what happened when in the airplane, in the air, anything in the plane, any component get fail, it has no chance. So it is very critical thing. So, and it is life threatening as well. So such kind of philosophy acts there. Now see, I have the example. Here we have six legged stool. Earlier we have three legged stool. Now we have six legged stool. And consider one of the leg get fail. It may imbalance. It may imbalance, but it will not fail. Or it get instead of fail. What I am talking instead of means in failure, it gets cracked. Means one of the leg. Say this leg get cracked here, but it is still there. But it can, other five legs can easily handle the load. And this particular until this particular portion get repaired, so you will get the repairing time as well. So here it is not this case. If this particular leg get failed, the stool will collapse. Now the damage tolerant, this is the middle ground between safe and fail. The middle ground philosophy is in here, damage, it is kind of damage tolerant. This philosophy adopted heavily in the aerospace community and the nuclear power generation. It relies on the assumption that a flaw already exists and that periodic inspection schedule will be set up to ensure that crack does not propagate to critical state between the inspection period. As implied, this philosophy adopts the crack growth method. Here what happened, again we'll check this, take the same example. We have four leg step. Instead, no, we don't have three, we don't have six. This is the middle. We have four leg step. We are already assuming that there is crack in the leg. What we are doing? We are doing periodic inspection. After week, after month, we are periodically inspecting it. And if there is any problem, we can solve that thing as well. So this is the damage tolerant. We are, means we are tolerant. We can avoid the accident in the future. So this is kind of maintenance thing in the other language. So there are life estimation method which are related to fatigue failure. So first is stress life, that is SN method, is commonly referred to as the total life method since it makes no distinction between the initiating or a growing a crack. This is the stress versus number of cycle method. Then the local strain or local life method, commonly referred to as a crack initiation method, was more recently developed and is intended to describe only the initiation of the crack. In this local strain, you will get the idea of initiation of the crack. And crack growth, that is damage tolerant method, we have seen what we talked earlier. Fracture specifically describe the growth of or propagation of crack once it has been initiated and has given rise to many so-called crack growth methodologies. So we have three different type of method to which can estimate the life. Life means how many cycle this any object can sustain. I am again taking the example of crankshaft. I am again taking the example of connecting rod. If we start any vehicle, if we want to predict the life cycle of the object, that object, whether it is connecting rod or whether it is crankshaft or whether it is piston as well, all are under the cyclic loading. Then we can, using the SN method, we are using the strain life method, we can give the life or we can estimate the life. We can say that it will sustain up to 10 to the power 6 cycle, or we can say that it can sustain up to 1000 cycle, or we can say that it can sustain only 1000 below 1000 cycle. So this methodology can tell us how many cycle object can sustain before get failed. So stress life, it is long life or high life cycle fatigue problem. This particular stress life SN method used composite welds, plastic and other non-ferrous material. Here the stress life cycle is used. Strain life, this is for the low cycle where the plasticity is dominant, mostly defect free metallic structure or component. Safety is is critical component, means here safety is very important. Then the crack growth and damage tolerant design. Pre-cracked structure during the welding or etc. during the welding, whatever the pre-crack structure we get. Determine the amount of life left after the crack initiation, means for this third is very different. We know there is a crack and we are estimating how much life it is having after the crack. So using these three method, you can estimate the life of any object under the fatigue failure. So this is very important thing, endurance limit. The fatigue or endurance limit of a material is defined as the maximum amplitude of completely reversed stress that the standard specimen can sustain for an ultimate number of cycle without fatigue failure. Cycles are usually 10 raised to power 7, sorry. And the related terminology come with SN curve, that the first methodology. What endurance limit is saying? It is saying that maximum amount of stress it can take during the cyclic loading. Here we can get its exact amount of stress, how much stress it can take. So on the log graph paper, we are getting this thing. So we have the specimen and it is continuously under the compression and tension. So it is continuously compression and tension. And here we will read it. As the number of cycles are increasing, see, number of cycles are increasing, the stress taking capacity goes on decreasing. It is goes on decreasing. Here it is SUT. Then you will get the SYT as well somewhere here, and again it goes on decreasing. Means for 10 cycle it can sustain this much amount of stress, for 10 to the power 1 cycle it can sustain this much amount of stress, and after that stress it get failed. What it is showing, that it gets failed, and for 10 to the power 2, 10 to the power 3, but after some time you are finding that as the number of cycles are goes on increasing, this stress carrying capacity remains same. Means here you can say that this particular, for this stress, the object become made for the infinite life. So in this way we can divide SN curve into two part. First is a low cycle, as these are the low cycle, means here number of cycles are less than 1000. Then the high cycle stress, here the stress is less and the number of cycles are higher than 1000, but this is finite life, means at some other point it may get failed. But if we want that particular thing for the infinite, then we must work on the endurance limit stress. This is the endurance limit stress, guys, which is very very below the failure stress or permissible stress as well, and it is denoted by SE or sigma E as well. So if we want infinite cycle of our object, means infinite amount of alternating or fatigue load, if we want to act on our object, then we must ensure that only endurance stresses can be generated on our object, otherwise it gets failed. So see here, as the number of cycles are increasing, low cycle fatigue, high cycle fatigue and infinite, here the stress values goes on decreasing, and here the stress value, if stress value is high, then the number of cycle are low, and as it goes on stress value decreasing, the we can increase the number of cycle as well. So here we can conclude this thing, endurance strength. A little consideration will shown as that stress is kept below certain value as shown by dotted line, endurance stress limit or material will not fail whatever may be the number of cycle. What it is saying, that whatever may be the number of cycle, if our stress value is below this particular line, which line? This is the endurance limit line, this is the endurance stress, this is the yield point stress, this is the ultimate stress. Somewhere here it lies permissible stress as well. So first is ultimate stress, then the yield point stress, then we divide both thing by the factor of safety, and we will get here at this region we are getting permissible or design, or we call it as a failure stress, but this is for the static loading. But when we think about the cyclic loading, this value again goes on decreasing, and as the number of cycle increases, and here we are getting the endurance stress. And if we want to run our object for the infinite life cycle, then we must keep it below the endurance stress. So endurance strength is defined as safe maximum stress which can be applied to the machine part working under the actual condition. This term is used refer fatigue strength of the material. This is the strength for the fatigue. If we keep our stress value below the endurance strength, then our object will run for the infinite life. So this is the thing which we need to take care. So what is the fatigue failure criteria, guys? Let's see. This is the sine curve we have. Alternating stress upper from here, this is the time, and this is for the applied stress. Upward we are considering for the tension, and this one is for the compression, and it goes on tension to compression, compression to tension, and alternating load goes on carry out here. So few terminologies we need to check out. First is stress range, that is sigma r, sigma max to sigma max minus sigma min. Then the variable stress, this is sigma v, which is equals to sigma max minus sigma min divided by 2. This is the variable stress. Then mean stress is equals to sigma max plus sigma min divided by 2. Here we are considering tension in the positive and compression as the negative. So little mathematical consideration, we can say that at this case our sigma min is 0, because sigma max and sigma min is same, and here if we put sigma min in negative, so sigma max minus sigma min and divided by 2, we will get the same answer, whereas this minus and this minus will get add, and we will get some value of sigma variable. So I hope you are getting what I am trying to tell you. So the case shown above is having the mean stress 0 because the maximum stress and minimum stress is same. But in many cases this is not possible. Tensile mean stress positive, tensile mean stress, that is positive mean stress value, is not good for longer fatigue like. So mean stress can be determined by S N curve, but this method is very time consuming. Means we can mean stress we can decide it by using the S N curve, but this particular methodology is very time consuming. So here we have come up with some different criterias or different approaches. So Goodman diagram. So before going into Goodman diagram, we need to know some nomenclature. We are dividing variable stress sigma A or sigma V, then the stress range sigma R, mean stress sigma M, ultimate stress SUT, yield point SYT, endurance strength stress sigma e, and factor of safety by capital N. So we are draw it. This is the sigma v variable stress. We can denote it. This is also called as amplitude stress as well. That's why I wrote here sigma a. So this is the sigma v variable versus sigma me m diagram. And somewhere here, if this is the SUT value and this is the endurance strength value which we have drawn, and if we draw a line which joins the sigma e and SUT, can you see that we have drawn the line sigma e to SUT? Any stress value which lies below this particular Goodman line, then we can call it as it is a safe stress. This is the shortcut method which bypasses the SN curve. So see, any value which is under the this particular triangle, we can say that this is the safe stress for that component, for that material, whatever the design it has made.
So we must know the endurance strength, we must know the SUT value, we must know the SYT value of that object. This is the Goodman method. The area below the curve indicates that the material should not fail given the stresses. The area above the curve represents likely failure. So this particular Goodman, along with the Goodman, there are another methodology. Instead of SUT, we are taking now SYT and we are joining it to the sigma. Now that particular methodology is given by the Soderberg. So Soderberg is much safer as compared, it is much safer because the stress value is decreasing comparatively. And the third is Gerber, which is the parabolic curve, or rather I'll say a curve which we are getting here from sigma e to SUT, and the below it, whatever the stress value, Gerber is saying that it is safe. Goodman is given its own methodology and Soderberg is provided its own methodology. So we have the formulas for every method: Goodman criteria, Soderberg, and Gerber criteria. Goodman criteria is safer. If we consider it is quite, we can use this thing. We can we can rely on the Goodman criteria. It is more, Soderberg is more conservative and consideration, and it is more safer than Goodman, because conservative means if we are reducing the SUT value and we are keeping, we are coming to the SYT, means it is giving more safer solution. Whereas in Gerber criteria, what happened? It is a parabola and excludes some of the area which is nearby to the failure region C. As what Goodman told, that from sigma E to SUT and below region is safe. And what happened in this particular method, due to parabolic, this much of area which Goodman is telling us that you can't rely on this portion which may get fail, the stresses in this area, and Gerber is cover that particular portion. So Gerber is quite risky as compared to other. So guys, this is all about the fatigue failure, means when while you are operating the software, you will get all this particular terminologies: Goodman, Soderberg, what is Gerber, then completely reverse cycle and all this thing. You have already learned this thing in the engineering. I am just recapping each and everything. So we'll move forward for the buckling failure. What is the buckling failure? Under the compressive load, slender members such as columns can become structurally unstable, leading to a sudden failure. The sudden loss of stability under the compressive load is referred to as a buckling. Buckling failure usually occurs with elastic range of the material. From this particular diagram, you can get the clear idea. Have you seen this thing earlier as well? What I told you, that these are the common columns we see below the bridges, and this is the connecting rod. Pure compression is in the connecting rod. Here also pure compression, and due to compression we can see the buckle kind of thing, and this is the failure. So what is the buckling load? When the object applied with some load and object shows sign of buckling, it tends to failure. The load at which object buckle, it is known as buckling load or critical load or a crippling load. At load at which the object start buckling, it is called as buckling load. So what we have concluded from here, buckling load is not safe, because when we apply buckling load on the column, on the member, it will start buckle, and buckling is not good for that particular thing, because buckle means failure. So buckling load is not allowed on the object, because if buckling load act, then it gets failed. Then what type of load is allowed? The load allowed is safe load. The load at which column stands without failure is known as safe load. But how to calculate the safe load? So there are three methods. First find the buckling load using the Euler's or criteria or Rankine's criteria. This is quite theoretical thing you have learned already. Using that, you can find out the buckling load. Then select the factor of safety. Generally here factor of safety is above 3. And formula is very simple. Safe load is equal to buckling load divided by factor of safety. So whatever the load we can get from this formula is the load which is allowed to act on that particular object, any kind of load which is above the safe load is considered the danger for that particular object. So here we can conclude that we have the first case where the safe load is less than buckling load, that's why there is no buckling. And the second case, buckling load is higher than safe load, and we can see the result that it is get buckled. So guys, this is all about what we have seen today: static failure, fatigue failure, and buckling failure as well. Actually, I have focused more on the fatigue failure because it is quite large topic. So thank you very much, and keep watching. In next class, I will come up with the another example on the ANSYS where we can solve the static, how we can see how object actual object behaves in the ANSYS for the static, fatigue, as well as the buckle failure. So thank you very much, keep watching and subscribe the channel for the latest update.